clinical manifestations of relapsing polychondritis. The onset of relapsing polychondritis, it is frequently abrupt. That is, it can start suddenly with appearance of one or two sites of cartilaginous inflammation, and the pattern of cartilaginous involvement and frequency of episodes, it varies widely among patients. And even non-cartilaginous presentations also occur. So this include systemic inflammatory features such as fever, fatigue, and weight loss occur. And these inflammatory features, they may precede the clinical signs of relapsing polychondritis by several weeks. And this relapsing polychondritis, it might go unrecognized for several months or even years. So generally in patients like who initially manifest intermittent joint pain and or swelling, or sometimes patients might present with unexplained eye inflammation, hearing loss, valvular heart disease, or pulmonary symptoms. So in these patients, relapsing polychondritis, it goes unrecognized for several months or even years, whose manifestations, initial presenting features are different, like joint pain, swelling, or unexplained eye inflammation, hearing loss, valvular heart disease, or pulmonary symptoms. The most frequent presenting manifestation of relapsing polychondritis is auricular chondritis, that is inflammation of the auricle. So this occurs in 40% of patients, and eventually affecting about 85% of patients. So one or both ears are involved. Either they are involved simultaneously or sequentially. So patients, they experience sudden onset of pain, tenderness, and swelling of the cartilaginous portion of the ear. So this inflammation, it typically involves the pin of the ears, sparing the ear lobes, because they do not contain cartilage. It involves the pin of the ears, sparing the ear lobes, because they do not contain cartilage. And the overlying skin, it has got a beefy red or a violaceous color. And prolonged or recurrent episodes of this inflammation leads to cartilage destruction, and this results in a flabby or droopy ear. And so sometimes the swelling may close off the eustachian tube or external auditory meatus, because the swelling is closing off the eustachian tube or external auditory meatus, it causes impairment of hearing. And inflammation of the internal auditory artery or its cochlear branch, inflammation of the internal auditory artery or the cochlear branch of the internal auditory artery produces hearing loss, vertigo, ataxia, nausea, and vomiting. And vertigo is almost always accompanied by hearing loss. And approximately 61% of patients, they'll have nasal involvement. So patients will, they might experience nasal stuffiness, rhinorrhea, and epistaxis. Nasal stuffiness, rhinorrhea, and epistaxis. And so the bridge of the nose and the surrounding tissue, it becomes red, swollen, and tender, and collapse. It produces a saddle nose deformity. In some patients, this nasal deformity develops insidiously without overt inflammation. And the saddle nose, it is more frequently seen in younger patients, especially in women. And joint involvement, it is also the presenting manifestation in relapsing polychondritis. And it is seen in approximately one-third of the patients. And it will be present for several months before other features appear. And so more than half of the patients will have arthralgias or arthritis. The arthritis is usually asymmetric, and it is oligoarthritis or polyarticular arthritis, and it involves both large joints as well as small peripheral joints. So arthritis is usually asymmetric and oligo or polyarticular, and it It involves both large and small peripheral joints. So the episode, it lasts from days to several weeks, and this episode, it resolves spontaneously without any joint erosion or deformity. It resolves spontaneously without any joint erosion or deformity. And attacks of arthritis, it might not be temporary related to other manifestations of relapsing polychondritis. And if you aspirate the joint fluid, it has been reported to be non-inflammatory. And in addition to the peripheral joints, and inflammation might also involve the costochondral joints, sternomanubrium joint and sternoclavicular cartilage. So destruction of these cartilage, it results in a pectus excavatum deformity or even a flail anterior chest wall. In addition to peripheral joints and inflammation might also involve costochondral, sternomanubrial and sternoclavicular cartilages. So destruction of these cartilages results in a pectus excavatum deformity or even a flail anterior chest wall. And eye manifestations, this also occurs in more than one half of the patients. And so different eye manifestations include conjunctivitis, episcleritis, scleritis, iritis, uveitis and keratitis. So this ocular inflammation, it can be severe and sometimes it might be visually threatening. So other manifestations include there could be eyelid and periorbital edema, proptosis, optic neuritis, that is inflammation of the optic nerve, extraocular muscle palsies, retinal vasculitis and renal vein occlusion. And among the serious manifestations of relapsing polychondritis, laryngotracheobronchial involvement, it occurs in 50% of patients. So symptoms include hoarseness, a non-productive cough and tenderness over the larynx and proximal trachea. Hoarseness, non-productive cough, tenderness over the larynx and proximal trachea. And there also might be mucosal edema, strictures and collapse of laryngeal or tracheal cartilage. And it causes stridor and life-threatening airway obstruction necessitating a tracheostomy. And involvement, it can also extend into the lower airways resulting in tracheobronchomalacia. And there also will be collapse of cartilage in the bronchi. It leads to pooling of secretions and this leads to pneumonia. And when extensive, this leads to respiratory insufficiency. And apart from respiratory system, even cardiac system, cardiac valvular regurgitation, it occurs in about 5 to 10% of patients. So there will be progressive dilatation of the valvular ring or to destruction of the valve cusp. And aortic regurgitation occurs in about 7% of the patients, with the mitral and other heart walls being affected less often. So there will be cardiac valvular regurgitation. This is due to progressive dilatation of the valvular ring or to destruction of the valve cusp. And other cardiac manifestations include pericarditis, myocarditis, coronary vasculitis and conduction abnormalities. And aneurysms of the proximal, thoracic or abdominal aorta may occur even in the absence of active chondritis, and occasionally these aneurysms might rupture. Renal disease, it occurs in about 10% of patients, and the most common renal lesions are mesangial expansion or segmental necrotizing glomerulonephritis. One segment gets necrotized, so it is segmental necrotizing glomerulonephritis. And tubulointerstitial disease and IgA nephropathy have also been reported. Tubulointerstitial disease and IgA nephropathy has also been reported. In the segmental necrotizing glomerulonephritis, small amounts of electron dense deposits will be there in the mesangium, and there is also faint deposition of C3 and or IgG or IgM. So small amounts of electron dense deposits in mesangium, and there is also faint deposition of C3 and or IgG or IgM. This is seen in segmental necrotizing glomerulonephritis. And 25% of the patients have skin lesions. These include purpura, erythema nodosum, erythema multiforme, angioedema, urticaria, livedo-reticularis, and paniculitis. And features of vasculitis are seen in about 25% of patients, and it can affect any size vessel. So large vessel vasculitis, it presents with aortic aneurysm, and medium vessel vasculitis, it might affect coronary, hepatic, mesenteric or renal arteries or vessels supplying the nerves. And skin vessel disease and involvement of the post capillary venules can also occur. Skin vessel disease and involvement of the post capillary venules can also occur. And one specific overlap syndrome is MAGIC syndrome, mouth and genital ulcers. MAGIC means mouth ulcers and genital ulcers with inflamed cartilage. So this patient presents with features of both relapsing polychondritis and Behçet's disease. MAGIC syndrome, mouth and genital ulcers with inflamed cartilage, in which patient presents with features of both relapsing polychondritis and Behçet's disease.